under Section 5, specific act. There are these grounds wherein it has been mentioned as to how the specific relief is given. And in that perspective, we were going through the grounds step by step. And in the last chapter, when we were discussing the specific performance, we have gone through Section 8 and 9. Now today, the specific performance of agreement to sell is our subject, and we are going to discuss it. Whenever there is an agreement to sell between the parties, the first question which arises as to whether it is an enforceable agreement or it is not, and for the purpose of determining whether an agreement is valid and is capable of enforcement, we are to see certain grounds which will be enabling us to find out whether a suit for specific performance of an agreement to sell can be filed on the basis of that certain document. The agreement to sell may be performed whenever it is an oral one, and it may also be performed when it is in writing. But in both these situations, we find that the criterions are different. When there is an agreement to sell in writing, it shall mean that we are to prove certain things to enforce the document. First of all, we are to go through the conditions and the terms of the agreement to find out whether it is a valid contract, because an agreement enforceable at law is a contract, and when it is a contract, then it shall be enforced specifically. So for the purpose of determining that whether this agreement is enforceable or not, we are to see certain things. Number one, whether the contents of the document purporting to be an agreement to sell is in its effect a contract under the Contract Act. So for the purpose of determining the matters in controversy, first of all, we are to determine whether this document is validly executed or not. So the first and the foremost important thing for the enforcement of the agreement is whether it was validly executed between the parties. What does it mean? It means that the execution is of such a nature that the agreement can be legally enforced. So in the document there should be an executant, and it should be between the parties. So for the purpose of valid execution, the question is as to how the valid execution of a document is to be proved. First of all, we have to see as to how the execution is to be proved. For the purpose of proof of valid execution of a document, we are to go through Article 17 and 79 of Kanuni Shahadat Order 1984. Article 17 says, when there is a financial or future obligation, it requires that there should be two witnesses on the document. So the two attesting witnesses, which are popularly known as the attesting witnesses, are necessarily to be the persons attesting the execution of the document. And then what is the attestation? It has been defined in the TP Act Section 3, but today we are not going to discuss what the attesting witness is. The only thing which are to be determined today is that under Article 79, when a document is required by the law to be attested by two witnesses, it should be proved by the production of those two documents. So for the purpose of valid execution of the document, there should be two attesting witnesses. And when there are two attesting witnesses, we find on the document, they are to prove the attestation of the document and should state and depose before the court that the executant made his signatures or thumb of the document in their presence or admitted the acknowledgement thereof. So the valid execution is necessary to be proved. And when the valid execution is proved, then we have to see that there is consideration. There can be no contract without consideration. For the purpose of valid execution, it is necessitated that the consideration must be valid. So when we are discussing the valid execution of the document, we are also to peep into the fact that a consideration also passed on, and it was agreed between the parties that there shall be a consideration. So for the purpose of specific performance of the agreement itself, the first and the most important ingredient is the proof of a valid execution of the document. And the second is that there must be a consideration which is valid in accordance with the law of the contract. So if there is no consideration, there can be no contract. And if there is a consideration, it should be a valid consideration. Valid consideration means that it should be lawful, and the law should recognize the consideration. And any consideration which is not recognized by the law shall not be taken as a legal one, and the contract shall be void and shall not be enforced if the consideration is not valid. The third question is that if the petitioner, appellant, or the person who is deriving benefit from the contract and intends to get it enforced is in possession of the property or not. So if he is not in possession of the property, then the question arises as to why did he not get the possession of the property at the time when the document was being executed. But if he alleges that the possession was delivered to him, then we have to see that he is in possession of the property in pursuance of the agreement. But if he is already in possession of the property as a tenant, as a lessee, as a juridical possessor, that shall not be considered at all. The only point which needs consideration is that the possession was delivered in pursuance of the agreement. If A was in possession of the property as owner of the property, then after the agreement was executed, B became in possession of the property, it shall be a good evidence of the fact that the agreement was entered into between the parties and the both parties agreed to transfer the possession. And when the possession is transferred from one party to the other, so at the time when the document was executed, it shall be deemed that it was in pursuance of the agreement. So when we are going to file a suit for the specific performance of contract, it is necessitated that the question of possession is also to be pleaded in the plaint. And if he is in possession of the property under the agreement, he must specify it that he got the possession in pursuance of the agreement. But if he is already in the possession of the property, then he must state that he was already in possession of the property and the person executing the document acknowledged the possession under the agreement. So there are certain circumstances that a man is already in possession of the property. In those eventualities, in those situations, he must have to prove that the owner of the property, executant of the document, acknowledged his possession under the agreement. Then these are the three basic things, but there are certain matters which are to be taken into account while the plaint is being drafted for the specific performance of an agreement, and that is the circumstances. We have to see the circumstances wherein the document was executed, and it shall be sufficient to draw certain inferences when we are considering the circumstances. There may be a circumstance that a man is not available at the spot. Then if he is not available at the spot, then there was no question of executing the document. When he claims the plea of alibi, meaning thereby in the time of execution he was somewhere else, and he proved that he was not present at the time when the document actually was executed, it shall mean that the circumstances are going against the plaintiff. And there are certain other circumstances. The man was sick, the man was ill, he was not capable to perform his duty to execute the document. He was not capable to go to the court to purchase the document. He was not in a position to understand the language of it. So there are certain and several circumstances which are sufficient to draw certain inferences. And when there are circumstances which could enable us to draw the inferences, those are very much material. For the sake, for instance, we can see that if there are strained relations between the parties, they are not in good terms, they are in the hot water and they are in the cold blood relations, and they are not taking good relationing, they are not on speaking terms, they never like to meet one another. So in those situations, it may be inferred that the circumstances required that there could be no agreement between the parties. But if this is the situation, then it is incumbent upon the plaintiff to meet the situation that although there were not good relations between the parties, even then they entered into the contract due to other certain circumstances. So those circumstances which are sufficient to cut down these circumstances are not only to be pleaded but also to be proved by the plaintiff. But if he does not prove or he fails to prove to counter the circumstances which are prevalent on the face of record, he shall not be entitled thereto. And there is the fifth aspect of the matter, and that is the probabilities. So the civil law is always inclined to understand, to explain the probabilities. And there are certain cases when direct evidence is not available. And there are circumstances when the eyewitnesses are not available. There are circumstances when the attesting witnesses are not found. There are certain circumstances that the evidence is not within the process of the court, and there are certain circumstances that the witnesses have become hostile. And there are certain other circumstances wherein it is not possible for the plaintiff to prove his case. Then the probabilities come into field. The science of probability is very much material. The science of probability is very much important, and the science of probability is very much relevant. But when we talk of the relevant, what does it mean? When we say that the probabilities are very relevant, so we have to consider what the relevant is. If we come to the conclusion that these probabilities are relevant to draw an inference in favor of the execution of the document, then of course we shall be in a position to understand that these are the probabilities. Now we have to see the two things. Number one, what is relevant probability? Number two, how an inference can be drawn from the probabilities. It is the civil law which recognizes the probabilities as a piece of evidence to draw certain inferences. And an inference, if drawn in favor of the execution, the court may come to the conclusion that the document was validly executed. Now we have to see, first of all, what are the relevant probabilities. You will be astonished to understand that Kanun-e Shahadat does not define relevant. Under Kanun-e Shahadat, there are certain provisions containing the facts relevant for the purpose of determination. Those articles specify as to this fact is relevant, this fact is not relevant, this is relevant, this is relevant. So there are certain articles which prescribe the relevant facts, but it does not mean that they are defining the relevant. So the question of defining the relevant is altogether different from those articles which are in the Kanun-e Shahadat. Now you will see that we are to consider the relevant fact when we are considering the probabilities. But when we are considering the execution of the document, when we are considering the consideration of the agreement, when we are considering the possession of the property, and when we are considering the circumstances, then we are to see those relevant facts which have been declared relevant under Kanun-e Shahadat. But when we are considering the probabilities, then the scope is wider. The scope of relevant becomes wider because the opinion is to be formed by the court itself. Then the court is forming its opinion on the basis of probabilities of the relevant facts, which are not necessarily provided in Kanun-e Shahadat, Order 1984. So for the purpose of determining the science of probabilities, we are to consider as to what the relevant is. Now I am going to define it. Relevant means any two facts to which it is applied are so related to each other that according to the common course of events, one either taken by itself or with other facts proves or renders probable the past, present or future existence or non-existence of the other. So there should be a fact at issue and there should be another probable fact which should be in consonance with the fact at issue, or which should be in contradiction of the fact at issue. When there exist two facts, one fact at issue and the other is another fact which may be able to, which may enable us to draw a conclusion regarding the fact at issue, and the fact at issue is to be determined on the, in the light of that relevant fact which is sufficient to draw an inference regarding the probabilities. So the probabilities are very important in certain circumstances, and the probabilities are very important in certain cases. Now what the science of probability says? The science of probabilities is to be taken into account the possibilities are not in infinity. This is the basic principle which to be taken into account, that when we are considering the question of probabilities, it should be taken into account. And it can be taken into account that the probabilities are not infinity. But when we say that these are not infinity, it means they are limited. And when these are limited, it means we can count them. If they are not infinity, and they are to be considered as a limited one, then the limited things can be counted. No doubt, sometimes these may be billions, these may be thousands, these may be hundreds, and these may be some and several, but these shall not be unlimited. But if the probabilities are limited, these are not countless. And if these are not countless, we can count them. And the thing which can be counted may be considered. And when these can be counted and considered, then we shall get some facts which are probable to draw an inference. Up to this time, we are clear that probabilities are not infinite. Suppose I have a coin in my hand. I throw it up in the air. There are four possibilities, four probabilities. Number one, when it is in the air, you will catch it. Second is, it shall fall on the ground in one side or on the other side. And fourth one is that it shall neither fall on the right nor fall on the left. It shall remain standing in the sand. So there are four possibilities when you are throwing a coin. There is no fifth one.
Yes.
There can be no fifth one probability. So we have counted that when we are throwing a coin in the air, there are only four possibilities. Now one of them must be correct. One of them must be real. One of them must be a fact. And one of them must be truth. And more, if we go ahead, one must be real. So when we are counting the probabilities, we shall come to this conclusion that these are not countless and one of them is real. It cannot happen that all are incorrect. All probabilities are not incorrect. One of those probabilities must be real. So it is the duty of the liars and the courts, when they are facing the question of probability, they are to count them and then find out one of them to be the real one. Now the question is, what is the criteria to find out the real one? How much time?
Seven minutes.
One is, I was saying that it is a duty of the courts to find out the real one. How? Here we are to get support from modern rationalism. It is only the modern rationalism which provides us the 10 pillars to find out the reality. So as a court, as an advocate, we must be aware of those 10 pillars which help us in finding out one reality from the bundle of probabilities. So the most difficult task of a liar and a judge is to face the probabilities and to pick out one reality on the basis of those 10 pillars. And if a man does not know as to what those 10 pillars are, his finding shall be not possibly correct. That may be correct, but there are chances that it might not be correct. So if it is not correct, then the result shall not be correct. And when the result is not correct, unfortunately, judgment shall not be correct. So the better situation in a suit for specific performance of contract is not to go up to the probabilities. We are to see that there is a valid execution of a document. We are to see that there is a valid consideration. We are to see that the possession was delivered in pursuance of the agreement and the circumstances exist to believe that this is a valid document. It was executed properly. So when we are going to do that, then it shall be easy for us to find out the fact and dig out the reality. If these four characteristics are available before us, then the job is easier than that when we are facing the probabilities. But when these effects are available, we can draw an inference. The first thing with the court is to do that is it is to find out the fact. Then after finding out the fact, the court should dig out the reality. And when the reality is dug out, then the court may apply the law. So these are the three stages to come to a definite conclusion. Number one, to find out the fact. Number two, to dig out the reality. And number three, to apply the law. So these are the three subjects which may be dealt with independently in a different lecture. But today, we are concerned as to how far we are connected for the purpose of specific performance of an agreement. So the next point is that how the probabilities are to be considered, how a definite conclusion can be drawn from the probabilities, and what is the limitation on the subject. So this is the most important thing, that we are to see what the limitation is applicable in a suit for specific performance of contract. So there are certain contingent contracts. How a cause of action arises in a contingent contract, and when the cause of action arises, how the period of limitation is to be computed. And the next is whether the plaintiff is willing or ready to perform that part of the contract. So there are three more subjects which remain for discussion, are the contingent contract, limitation, plaintiff willingness, and then equitable relief. Thereafter, we shall see that what are the circumstances wherein a suit for specific performance the contract may be filed. And it is an equitable relief. How far the equity demands and how far a man to fulfill the equity. And when the equity is fulfilled, then it is discretionary with the court to grant this decree for specific performance of contract. Then another point will come, okay, whether the decree passed in a specific suit for specific performance is a preliminary decree or a final decree. So these points shall be considered in the inshallah.